Well, an exhibition, you know, is like a symphony, a classical symphony. There is a main theme and a second theme and possibly a third one. The main theme is the one that is written on the manifesto, on the book, on the catalog. But very highly linked to it, there is a second theme that is, we want to see and talk about architecture in the making. We want to see architecture as not as a way to give responses in terms of volume and forms, but a way to proceed from needs, desire, decisions to be taken by individual, by institutions, obstacles that have to be overcome, difficulties and that are found, and failures and successes. We are very much interested in the phenomenology of architecture as a process through which we master our destiny and through which we do take part to a decision process. Therefore, all those who are invited to come and discuss and present their project are also kindly invited by us to tell us the story of it in terms of all these chains of these different moments, this chain of phenomena that have to take place from ideas, needs, to the conclusion and to the result. Problem solving is certainly among the main responsibility of the profession of the architect. And interesting architecture is where you see that a thinking, a mind has been applied to a problem, to solving a problem that was well identified, well interpreted, and with responses that were coherent with what were the need from which we started. So this is the second line that, together with Ravenna, we consider as the second, not in importance, but the second in terms of being the one that goes together with the other thread, a red thread that will accompany us through these 6 months. So I'm very glad and I'm most grateful for all the hosts that will give us their they are together with us this afternoon, and we take part of this dialogue, and most grateful for giving us all the tensions that the profession of the architect has to face, has to solve, has to provoke, and has to overcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming. Just a quick introduction for what to expect from this meeting. We ask different architects and participants of the Biennale that have a project over there to come once a month and to share in their own words with people what is what they're presenting there. Why should we care? What were the difficult moments, the tipping points, those moments where they were about to fail, or when there was a moment of creativity that allowed them to go from paper to reality? So Norman Foster, the city of Medellin, and Andrew Mackin in South Africa are these three participants that we would like to hear from them the insights of what they're presenting at the Biennale. 10 minutes each, more or less, and just share in a most open and relaxed way what it took to get these projects done. But we have two other persons, and well, the title infrastructure, it's because all these three projects tend to be connected to infrastructure, from the drone port to an abandoned piece of highway that was transformed in a market in Durban, or with the water tanks in the city of Medellin. Actually, not only even from the one that is the designer, even from the decision maker, former mayor of Medellin is here. But in addition to that, infrastructure and the quality of life in cities could be a theme, but there may be other challenges. And we have two people here in a position that they, as Maria Reiche on the ladder, may be seeing a reality that is much broader than what we may be seeing today. So Rem Koolhaas, also in the position of curator of the Biennale, but in his practice throughout the world, we would like to listen from him what he considers we should be thinking about and paying attention to as the challenges for the built environment. And Joan Kloss, who is in charge for the UN Habitat 3 meeting in Quito this October, the meeting about the urban agenda of the world that happens every 20 years, that actually will be about to really explain to the population of the world what are these challenges to come. So this is the idea, 10 minutes each, then we will open the conversation to questions and answers. And I would like to start with the three practitioners, first Norman Foster, then Andrew Mackin, and then the Medellin, city of Medellin, and then Rem Koolhaas, and finally Joan Kloss. Thank you.
There are probably three areas that overlap. Our project, the Drone Port, started with a friend, somebody I'd known for some time, a writer, a critic, and a kind of African buff, who was down the road from where I was living at that time, at EPFL in Lausanne, where he'd been headhunted to extend that university's outreach into Africa. And he said something along the lines of, "Norman, I know you're passionate about flight, you've flown sailplanes, helicopters, and so on, and you've also designed the biggest airports in the world. How do you feel about designing the smallest?" And he then went on to explain his concept of Africa, which suffers a lack of infrastructure, which is growing at an unprecedented rate. 2050, one in four people on the planet will be African, and virtually no infrastructure, and very challenging for it ever to catch up. So his idea, as he explained it, was to use the technology of drones, not in a military context, but in a humanitarian context, to deliver swiftly and very cheaply urgent medical supplies and also cargo. So he had these two concepts, the kind of the medical one, red line, and the other one, blue line. And he said, but where these touch down, it's like the equivalent of a filling station of a past era. And it's more than just a drone port. It's more than a place where the drones are serviced, where they're filled, emptied of their capsules containing supplies. It's probably closer to a medical center. It's a community center. It might be a market. And this building should have a kind of civic presence in the landscape. So out of that, I shared that idea with two of my colleagues, and we got to a certain point, and it seemed as if that would be really the end of it, and it was over to Jonathan to, with his contacts in Rwanda, which would be the first network linked into the hospitals and able to traverse very hostile landscape very, very swiftly. But I'm always, how can I say, impatient for the next step. And it seemed that the conventions of practice just were too restrictive. So through my foundation, I was able to harness the idealism of younger people, and I have to say, I have a tremendous enthusiasm for working with younger generations. And at ETH in Zurich, MIT in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Cambridge University in England, the Polytechnic in Madrid, the professors, the students, an engineering partnership derived out of that called ODB, and with the help of another foundation, the Lafarge-Holcim Foundation, and their research laboratory, out of that, in just a few months, we were able to bring the idea, first of all, through a half full-size mock-up, which was tested to destruction, and that involved a master mason in Madrid with the students and the professors there. And that then allowed us, with through experimentation, to derive a special product which is highly sustainable. It's essentially compressed earth. It's something like 91% earth, which can be dug locally at site, or could be imported in the form of a small unit, a kind of briquette, a cross between a brick and a tile. 1% additive and 8% cement. So 18,000 of these were made at very, very short notice. And the Droneport prototype vault, and the concept is a vault which is additive. So you can string a line of them, make a linear building, you can cluster them together to make a deep square building, put a courtyard in the middle, so infinitely flexible. And in 13 days, using this as a videoed exercise, which would provide the basis for an instruction manual for remote communities in emerging economies beyond Africa, because the need is really much wider. And there are a number of stories within stories, because the vault, it is believed, was born in Africa and exported via the Moors to Spain. And through one remarkable individual, Gustavino, in the transfer between the 19th and 20th centuries, did some extraordinary work with vaults, highly economical, fireproof, very, very beautiful, in the United States, in many, many cities. And so there's a certain circularity about the story, because using the computer skills of MIT to develop the most optimum compressive structure with the thinnest shell and the minimum mass, in other words, doing absolutely more with less, this in turn will be finding its way right back to its roots in Africa in a much more kind of high-tech developed form. But the important thing is that this, as a project, as a shelter, will be made locally. So it's providing jobs, and through that process, the community has ownership in it. It's not something that is kind of shipped out, helicoptered, and it becomes part of a true community project. Since then, and really the idea is that by demonstrating something you can touch, something that you can see, it's in one sense very humble. I mean, it's mostly made of mud. But I have always found a certain nobility in the making of things. So in that sense, we hope that it will be a stepping stone. People will see it. And it's not just a kind of paper vision, but it's one step closer to reality. I think it is part of the tip of a much bigger iceberg. Probably one third of humanity does not have adequate shelter. Likewise, one third of humanity, 2.3 billion, doesn't have adequate sanitation or clean water. And that lack of clean water translates into the death of 900 children every day. One in five individuals on the planet don't have access to power. And the relationship of a society, its infant mortality, its life expectancy, relationship to sexual, political freedom, violence, enlightenment is directly related to the consumption of power. And those societies which do have access to power, the population growth is slowed right down. And that one-fifth of humanity at the moment is in large part responsible for the growth of the population, which is something like 200,000 a day. And so the shelter is one aspect of this. And in personal terms, I think that on reflection, there is, if I take the aviation analogy, if you take the basic historic aircraft called a tail dragger, and you have a museum of old aircraft, it's very, very difficult to find pilots now who can fly those aircraft. They can fly the large, complex, digitally driven, large airliners safely with the aid of the air traffic controllers and the complex electronics. But interestingly, the pilot who put down the large aircraft into the Hudson River and everybody walked away safely happened to be a gliding instructor. So his prime hobby, his upbringing, was on the most basic of aircraft. If the pilot at the helm of that aircraft had been a typical recently trained pilot, that back to basics would not be able to prevail. So for me, one aspect of this project was coming back to the absolute basics of shelter, connecting with students, connecting with master masons, and in a way being part of that process, even if that was more like a kind of being able to expedite it, being able to bring those individuals and those skills together. So for me, that was a great privilege, and I'm very proud of the team that made it possible. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Maybe I can just explain some basic things about our country for people who are not familiar. We have a history of 400 years of colonialism and 40 odd years of essentially Nazi-like racial oppression. And its main consequences were to fracture every social link that existed in indigenous population of the country, to demonize and oppress people's indigenous cultures, very foreign to the settlers, and to break any economic networks that existed prior to colonization and to the system called apartheid, meaning separation. One of the main instruments used in this process was spatial. By separating all the pieces, in other words, if the analogy were a game of chess, to remove the king and the queen and the pawns and the bishops and all the pieces away from each other, it's not possible for there to be the ecology of the game anymore. And that's what these systems did. And by doing it for such a long period, you fundamentally disable people to initiate their own actions, because they have become themselves convinced that they are fairly worthless. And for the people whose intention that was a great success, because what you're then able to do is to turn people into highly capable forms of robots. And that's very good if you want to extract immense mineral resources from the ground. South Africa has the highest proportion of platinum group metals in the world. It's got one of the highest concentrations of uranium. It's got one of the highest concentrations of gold. The biggest diamond in the world was found in South Africa. So it was very attractive to be able to extract these resources, and it needed immense human labor to do so. But after 400 years of struggle, particularly 100 years of struggle through one particular organization who are now our government, this system was removed politically. That means that people can vote, but people are economically still slaves, entrapped by and large. The evidence for this is that we are now at 0.5% economic growth, which is a generous way of saying zero, which means that poverty can only get worse. It means that the disparity between rich and poor people can only get bigger, and that joblessness can only ever get more. The Market Project was a moment in time, 2 years after our democracy in 1994. And in that moment, many of the people that had been involved in the liberation struggle, highly skilled, deeply entrenched in the reality of life in South Africa, occupied in that moment most of the most influential positions, both in government, in the two forms, as politicians and as bureaucrats or as officials. And that enabled immense things to happen for, in fact, and unfortunately, a rather short period of time. And therefore, in that period, for about 8 years, our economic growth ramped up dramatically. As I say, it's dropped off dramatically again. What the market represents is the potential of natural energy, the energy and the demand and the desire of ordinary people to be themselves, to express themselves, to use their own ingenuity, not in a way that has arrived from somewhere else. In other words, it's mostly about getting rid of ideas as opposed to generating ideas. It's mostly about enabling people, or making it possible. The exhibition is called Enabling Structures. It's mostly about enabling people to, for their own, for want of a better way to describe it, their own river to flow, to remove the blockages, to step aside as architects and just to make possible what people already want to do. I think that really is the story of Nelson Mandela. It's about human dignity, and that everybody has within themselves almost limitless potential and possibility. I think Picasso said the same thing about the ability to draw. So the physicality of this environment was, as soon as democracy came, the cities now were no longer only for white people, who are only 5% of the population, and the cities now could be for everyone. And what happened in that moment is massive urban influx. With that urban influx came the projection of things that had been pushed out of sight in the formal world. Things like traditional medicine, which has been accepted by our formal medical council now as a valid form of medicine. Forms of food production, like eating, breaking open and eating cow's heads, cheeks are a delicacy on the street as a normal part of life. Of all sorts of herbal concoctions, both mythical and chemical, that cure both physical and emotional and scientific, in people's realities, cure these ailments. And this reality arrived with urban influx, and it occupied the area all around the main city railway station, until you could hardly drive a car down the streets, until you couldn't walk on the pavements any longer. People were trading there, until people trying to cross the road were knocked down like tens every day killed on the streets because it became so congested until the fire services couldn't get there. There were no ablutions for these immense numbers of people. And the team that responded to this was the new governing people, as I've mentioned who they were and how they got there, them, together with people, a range of other people, one of which were us as architects. Just one small piece. We did not invent this project. We are not the main protagonists of this project. We were one of the pieces on the chess board. And the main infrastructure that enabled this apparent chaos to achieve some kind of efficiency. I do not want to say order. There is no need for too much order in all of this, but for effectivity. The main thing that enabled this effectivity was that the apartheid government had designed a freeway exiting the city, and they had miscalculated the radius for the cars to land on the ground again, an upper level freeway, and so they never completed it. And at the end of this freeway, 8 meters below, was a major road. And people crossing that road were getting knocked down. And on the other side of that road were the major city markets. And all that this project is like putting a stent. I'm sorry, I don't know what that is in any other language than English. But a small spring inside a piece of your heart that is blocked and opening up the artery and letting it flow again. We built a bridge that linked the edge of the freeway to the other side of this road. And in the moment of opening that opportunity, everything fell into place. The people, Sangomas and Nyangas, people involved in dispensing and prescribing medicine in a traditional context, had a place to trade. It became a linear medicine market, like a linear pharmacy of traditional medicine. People who needed places to cook the animal heads, bovine heads, had a place to do this. People who boil and sell thousands and thousands of kilograms of maize that gets distributed, corn, around the city, had a place to do this. People that sew religious garments, we have a very strong connection between traditional religion and Western, call it religion, that people wear uniforms almost for religious ceremonies. They have a place to sew and sell these things. And many of those activities that happened there are in the exhibition. We tell 8 stories of individual people. There are people, for instance, that cut hair, not that I am in need of that myself, but people that cut hair under tents, basically on the street sides. Many of these are doctors and lawyers and engineers and ex-city officials from places like the Democratic Republic of Congo, DRC, or from neighboring countries in Central and South Saharan Africa who are displaced by violence in their country, and they come to South Africa because it's more stable, and they end up doing these things. All of this is accommodated to the extent that we invested 6,000 South African rand, which is about 6 million, which is about, I think, about 400,000 euros. I hope I'm right. And the consequence of that investment, which is very small, is a turnover, an economic turnover of money of 1.2 billion rand. That's 1 million euros. That's the relationship between investment and economic productivity. I think that, in other words, there is 200 more times money exchanged every year in this area than the investment made to generate that. I think anybody who is interested in yields would be very happy with that. This is what we are interested in. We're interested in doing things that have very small catalytic actions with immense consequences. A little bit like an atomic bomb. Do a little thing and have massive effect. Because if we are unable to do that, we have no future in our country. The challenges in this project were to remove the red tape and the rules and the parameters that had been established over many years of the imposition of power in our country in order to do a few things. For instance, in order to be able to integrate traditional social relationships and organizational structures with democratic social relationships and organizational systems. among the people, management systems, to remove the silos in the city of the sewage department and the fire department and this and that and the next department, and enable them to integrate around this project. Enable trust between individuals and groups of people who had been living for many generations without trust. So many of our challenges were human as opposed to physical challenges. So this project for us is something that has kind of given our actions a trajectory into the future to develop disciplines in the way in which we operate as architects, where our position is to make possible as opposed to introduce or provoke possibilities. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Alejandro, for this invitation. And let me say, first of all, two things about me. One is I'm not an architect. And the second is I speak a very beautiful Spanish, but a terrible English. And let me make the best effort. I am here with a very good friend, Horacio Valencia, an architect, chief of the EPM group of architects that make the project of UBAS. I am going to talk more generally about our city, Medellin, and the transformation that happened in the last 20 years. And then Horacio is going to talk more technically, focused in the project of UBAS. The first thing that I want to share with you about Medellin is that our city has 2.5 million people. It's the second largest city in our country, Colombia, in South America. But maybe many of you know that Medellin, 20 years ago, was the more violent city in the world. We face a very huge challenge in terms of violence, with more than 50,000 murders in 10 years. And this challenge of violence and the other big challenge of our society, the inequality, are for me the biggest challenge, not only for Medellin, but for Latin America and many of the cities of the world. Maybe here in Europe, in Asia, not the violence, but inequality is the biggest of the challenge, not only for cities, but for countries and society and civilization. And maybe you don't need a former mayor of Medellin to say that, but the interesting for me is that you, the architects, work in maybe the biggest tool that the world has now to fight inequality. And these are cities. Cities are the tool to fight the biggest inequality in our cities and in our societies in general. And one of the forms to fight this inequality is to build many and qualities public spaces and make urban innovations like Medellin was doing in the last 20 years. And the important thing of our experience is that work, because now we have a very different city that was selected like the most innovative city in the world 2 years ago and was awarded with the Lee Kuan Yew City Prize this year, and the project of UBAS with the Lafarge Holcim Gold Award. But the biggest award is that now we have 95% lower murder rate. And now we have the lower rate of poverty and inequality in our history. And another time, one of the tools to make this big transformation is urban innovation and architecture. And one of these projects, these very focused projects, is the project of UBAS, Unidades de Vida Articulada, United Life, Articulated Life, that we are presenting here in the Biennale. I am going to pass the floor to Horacio to explain the details of this, one of the transformations. We have another cables, Parker Biblioteca, River Park, urban transformation that are making more equality society and more peaceful society. Horacio.
Okay, thank you to everybody. Let me introduce you who I am, because I think so. Many people said, what is EPM? I would like to explain you what is EPM first. EPM is a public utilities company of Medellin, and is the largest company in Colombia for energy supply, water, reservoirs, gas, etc., etc. Has all of services integrated for public utilities. And our boss is the mayor. Aníbal was our boss because it's a public company. So what does mean, why that kind of company is making some project? Because we are thinking about our responsibility in our city, in the development of urban development. So the project that you can show here, the UBA project, that means about the how 50 years before, EPM did build a lot of tanks out of our city, in the big slopes in our mountains. So 50 years ago, that tanks was in the border. So now, the increasing of urban development into the slope and the highest mountain surrounded all of these tanks. So as Aníbal said, 20 years before, the dangerous city, the dangerous neighborhood, was has implication about how we can close our tanks and build a lot of walls around a big areas into Medellin in order to protect our infrastructure in water supplies and in energy stations. So now, when we did some master plan, and you can see the Medellin at night, you can see a lot of dark spots into urban development. So it's like an island for a big areas with water reservoirs. So in thinking about, okay, we have a lot of opportunities into a big density in our city, and we have a big problems in that neighborhoods. So what that means? That means that we have a lot of opportunity for open that walls and integrate a community in that areas that has not public space, that has not equipment, that has not opportunities for to enjoy some space for our community, because they has a lot of density of population into the neighborhoods. So now we are working with a project that opening that walls and integrate all of our tanks into a big development in our neighborhoods. So now the change that Aníbal said is really, really impressive, because before the tanks with the walls divided in a lot of communities, a different communities that never see it, that never, that cannot to contact to each other. And we had a lot of inconvenience and a lot of violent situation before. Than now that we are opening all of the walls and we are constructing and we are building a public space around these tanks.
I'm not here as a practitioner, therefore I think that I want to offer some reflections on the current situation. Maybe in general, I think we live at a very interesting moment where the initial, almost unquestioned enthusiasm for globalization is coming to an end for many different reasons. And where what we thought would be for mankind a huge benefit if there was unlimited traffic, unlimited influence, unlimited exchange between every culture, where that whole project seems to maybe not quite come to a halt, but demand of every one of us a much more intelligent and much more careful basis and intelligence in terms of why you can intervene in places where what you have to offer really and how well you understand the context in which you operate. So I think that's a crucial difference where initially we had almost like a luxury of working in hundreds of places and perhaps doing kind of interventions or making interventions that were not kind of particularly unique to those places. I think that has grinded to a halt, and I think that's a strong influence of the current moment. The second thing is that we've been talking now about cities, and of course the Biennale has been kind of from the year 2000 been almost a propaganda for cities. I think that we are also nearing a moment that of course we need to continue to work in cities. The city is of course a beautiful emancipatory machine. A lot depends on cities, but cities only occupy in the end 2% of the surface of the earth. And to the extent that kind of more and more people come into the cities, I think the question, what do they leave behind and what have they left behind, becomes also more important to explore. And I see in the kind of exhibition here that actually there are many kind of projects that are actually not looking quite at urban situations, but that the countryside or the non-urban condition is getting an attention that initially it or rarely had in the Biennale. I think that's very interesting, but I also feel that there is a number of phenomena that is happening in the city that in the countryside that exactly because we're not really looking at the countryside threatens to really remain invisible for too long. And I am kind of particularly fascinated by the manifestations of the digital world outside the cities. And maybe not only the digital world, but also the world, for instance, of Amazon, the world of distribution centers, the world of fulfillment centers, as they're used now called with a kind of beautiful euphemism, and the world of server farms, where at least there is a kind of in verbal terms an attempt to connect them to the countryside. I just came from an excursion to Nevada. The essence in this case of Nevada is the fact that it shares a border with California and that a city like Reno is, for instance, on the same latitude as Silicon Valley. And what you see there is that kind of Silicon Valley, which of course has been projecting the essence of the internet as some kind of ethereal, immaterial kind of entity that enables us all to have a kind of wonderfully light form of communication, actually needs a kind of massive infrastructure to kind of really support itself, and that infrastructure is now so enormous and achieves such an incredible scale that the idea of even putting it in cities has become completely impossible. What I, for instance, saw there is a battery factory of Tesla, the electric car, which is at this point perhaps 1 mile long and maybe actually 1.5 miles wide in the end. It's a kind of completely flat entity. Basically, it is simply there, there is no effort to kind of really understand it beyond its sheer kind of physical presence there. And that is not the only building there. There is also an Amazon fulfillment center, also of kind of really previously unknown dimensions, which again is simply there. And what I find really fascinating is, first of all, to consider whether we should, or architecture should, continue to ignore these kind of things and kind of say, well, this is happening, but it has nothing to do with us, or whether we are challenged to kind of find a symbolic purpose of it, or should make some kind of effort to make it an accessible part of the world's repertoire. And if so, how we can do that then? Because at some points, you know that the kind of the definition of the sublime is to be in awe of something for its properties of enormity or complete abstraction. And many of these kind of new structures actually come very, very close to being in those terms sublime, even though they are actually just kind of unfortunately slightly mediocre. So the question, I think, is not only whether architecture has a role to play in the kind of digestion in some way of this world, and therefore in the digestion of the kind of world, of the digital world, and try to find symbols for it or express it in symbolic terms. The other fascinating thing is that these buildings are all absolutely enormous, but they have very minimal number of inhabitants. They're largely automated, largely kind of robotized. So we have a kind of very interesting situation that the territory is as big as a metropolis, but the number of inhabitants is perhaps 1% of a metropolis. Yet there is outside space. There is kind of space which I hesitate to call public space because there's barely a public to actually inhabit it. There are kind of maybe some cars in the morning and some cars in the evening, but they don't even kind of form a rush hour. And very soon there will be probably driverless cars. So what is for me maybe kind of at this early point in the 21st century where you still begin to really see some contours of how it will eventually develop, how do we design and how do we define a kind of public realm in these situations? And is it, for instance, could we regain architectural initiative by simply embracing this abstraction, embracing even their lack of inhabitation, and go back to an architecture which is really radical or really stark, an architecture which is not beige, an architecture where there is no handicapped access, an architecture that can be really pure, stark, uninhabited, and amazing. I'm obviously not thinking that it will be that simple or that that would be the most interesting kind of outcome, but simply I think that sooner or later we will have to establish a relationship with the robotized kind of world. Do robots need free time, for instance, or do robots need to play, or should we imagine a new kind of playground where humans and robots interact in free time or in the factory? So this is what I think is one dimension of the countryside, which I would say is no longer the countryside, but is a form of high organization of the countryside to support realities that we continue to call urban, but which are actually transforming the countryside in a way which is more radical than kind of our cities are currently changed.
Thank you. Thank you. Let me explain a little bit the evolution of Habitat. As Aravena has said, Habitat has been the conference, Habitat 1, 2, and 3. They have been organized every 20 years. That means that if we are now in Habitat 3, it means that Habitat 1 was celebrated in Vancouver 40 years ago. It was 76. Just 2 or 3 years after the big convention of Stockholm, where the green movement began to take roots. The understanding after the report of the Cloma, of the Roma Club and all these things, then it was the first. Then Habitat One, the main underground underline message of Habitat One was try to keep the people in the rural areas. This was the main aspiration. In fact, it was parallel to the Green Revolution in India, in the productivity of agriculture, a different green meaning of the word. The idea by them, it was, let's keep the people in the rural areas. And even the program of the UN was called Human Settlements, because that idea was the prevailing idea. But in Habitat 2, was in Istanbul in 96, and between 76 and 96, the world population, urban world population, has increased 1 billion. And then, you know, that was a kind of surprise. You know, the program of keeping the people in the rural areas, if ever any country took it seriously, just failed strepitously. What happened is that the people was rushing to the city, and really without, you know, understanding fully why, we always have an answer for why the people go to the city from the rural areas, but the answers to that, they tend to be very philosophical, like for the look of better expectations for the people and the second generation and third generation. Okay. And then the Habitat 2, as it couldn't defend the idea that, you know, we need to do something to avoid the cities, the program of the Habitat 2, which came a little bit after Porto Alegre, it was about let's democratize the city. Let's talk about human rights, let's talk about participatory budgeting, let's talk about if you read the papers of Habitat 2, they are very optimistic in that sense, very social, very well-intended. We will sign all of them now, again, because all the good ideas are there. But now we are celebrating 20 years later Habitat 3. And I am asking you, is the city more democratic? Is the city more participatory? Is the city more, etc.? The answer is no. Then again, what was the underlying aspiration of 96 has not been fulfilled. Now we are trying to find out, well, then what are we going to talk about in Habitat 3? Because, you know, what do you want to Habitat 3 to talk about? Because we are not going to bring people back to the human settlements in the rural areas because the people don't want to go back. We already said everything about the quality of democratic governance and the utopian place as the city where all the different people can live together in a very nice community, you know, utopian. And instead of that, if you look at, we are doing for the first time, and we are going to offer that to the whole research community. We have done a sample of the cities, which is representative. And we are doing satellite photographies, and we are doing all the data for this sample. It's open source. Then you can work in this sample of cities, introducing, if you are interested, new layers of information. And we are always basing these studies in open source information. And what we have found in this open source, analysis of urbanization, is that first, the planet site of urbanization is increasing or decreasing in the world? What would you say? Are we now, as a percentage of the city, the planet, the part of the city which is more or less, in a sense, planet, compared to the spontaneous urbanization, what would you say that is increasing, the planet or the spontaneous urbanization? I guess? The spontaneous urbanization, very much. We are in planet Earth growing our urban footprint with less planning than 20 years ago. Another question. When spontaneous urbanization is growing, the first to suffer is the public space. If in a planet city or a planet exercise you have between 30 or 25 to 50% of the land is public space, when you go to spontaneous urbanization, you have in the slums 2% of public space, walk sites. And in the badly structured, privatized planning, something like 10% of the urban space is public space. That means that the overall urban public space is diminishing, which is another catastrophe, because with diminishing public space, you face a huge problem of accessibility, mobility, and of course political constraints. There's no places for the people to gather, etc., etc. There's a privatization of the urbanization. Well, one of the most interesting things that is happening in the world is the proliferation of gated communities. This is the end of urbanization, you know. If the model of urbanization, current model of urbanization, of quality urbanization, is a gated community, it means that we are finishing the utopian view of the city. The city is not anymore for the different to live together and interchange. The city is a place where you build interior walls, like in our cities in the Middle Ages, where we established walls. But at least the wall of the Middle Age city, it was a perimeteral wall, and it was defending the city from the adversary armies. But now we are building fantastic numbers of internal walls in order to protect ourselves from our neighbor, which is really an awful, evolution of urbanization. And you look, you make photos of these gated communities, and in many places you find this corrugated, spine with spine wires everywhere. You have a private warrens in the entry with a barrier, you know. And this is proliferating in the developed world for the elites or for the people who can pay. And in the developing world, this is proliferating because of the lack of security, feeling that the state is not providing some of the basic services like security that the state should provide. That is creating a photo of the urbanization, which is really very sad. In the last 20 years, we have seen many things. We have seen the financial crisis of 2008, by the way, originated by the subprime mortgages. We have seen, in another sense, the huge urbanization of China at a planetary level, because urbanized 500 million people at once, it's a real difficult question. And you can imagine the quality of these cities and what it represents. And also another thing that we have seen, and sometimes we don't talk much about that, is the eclosion of the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring was an urban revolution. It began in the plazas. It was about the youth, which were not, had not employment in the cities of the region. And the consequence of the Arab Spring, we are still living with them today. Even what is happening in Syria and in Iraq, in a way, it's a consequence, it's a derivative of the Arab Spring. Then if we begin to, if we continue to accumulate unemployed young people in the urban areas without, you know, future, I think that we are nurturing, we are feeding a time bomb that can create a lot of problems. This is why by Habitat 3 we have looked for another approach, and it's considered good urbanization, qualitative urbanization, as a tool for development. I know that a lot of people from the left react a little bit, why urbanization should be considered a tool for development. If development is not a very nice word now. Development, it's seen, you know, something, you know, which is not really very green, or but green development, well, yes, but it's a compromise, no. Development is out of fashion in a sense, in intellectually. But I can tell you that if you are at $1,000 per capita a year, development is something very much appreciated by the population. And I like the ideas of the three practitioners, because Norman has talked about a drone poor, which looks 21st century, you know, science fiction, but he's talking about the vaulting done with mud and with local products. And I think that this part of the project is very interesting in order to support the local economy. Or you have talked about this unfinished infrastructure and then building a bridge to connect to local markets or to public spaces. Also, not very much interested on the kind of beauty of the architecture, but the functionality of the architecture to solve a social problem there. Or in the case of Medellin, using the water deposits, that as Medellin has a lot of hills, in every one of the hills on top you have a water deposit to provide water for the area. And the typical reaction of the public administration was to wall the deposits to protect against attacks to or poisoning the water, etc. And those spaces around the deposit, now they have become the most and the only public space of the slum nearby the deposit. Then, you know, there's a kind of, we need to reinvent public space. We need to reinvent a new dialogue between the planning, who is in charge of the urban plan, because the problem is that in many cases, nobody's in charge of the urban plan, because the local authority has not the power. I am living in Nairobi, but I was, you know, the budget of Mombasa, the local authority budget of Mombasa in Kenya, which is a very interesting, a very economic moving city, it's $6 per capita and per year. Then with $6 per capita and per year, what are you going to do? Don't ask the mayor to do the urban plan. Then who is driving the urbanization process? Who decides where the street are laid out? Not the local authority, not the government. Who then is in charge of the public space? The answer is nobody. And you, when the mayor sees an investor at the distance, he lays out the red carpet. Oh, it's an investor. A little bit of, you know, money will come. What do you want to do? Oh, we would like to do a mall. How many hectares do you need? Six. pretending one. No, no, I'm not going to give you six. I am going to give you 10. And you build me a mall, and then you build here whatever, a middle-class housing, and the investor looks at the mayor and says, okay, where is the urban plan? No, you do it yourself. You do it yourself. But you know, the private sector is not in their genes, not in their knowledge, to do urban planning. Then what is the outcome? No public space. And then they are surprised. The mayor comes to me and tells, oh, the city's collapsed. The traffic, we are very poor. Only $2,000 per capita. Our rate of motorization is very low. 2 cars every 10 citizens, 20% of motorization. And we are already collapsed. And then you measure the public space of the city, and it's 12%. And then, you know, who is in charge? And this is the big question that we want to you know, we need to reinvent urban planning. We need to reinvent, you know, political governance of the city. We need to reinvent urban politics. And urban politics and urban planning in that sense is not a question or mainly a question of drawings. It's a question of designing the rules and regulations, it's a question of designing the public space, and it's a question of designing the financial workability of the city. And as that is not happening, what is moving at a speed unbelievable is a spontaneous urbanization without nobody in charge. And this is the big risk that the developing countries are facing. And looking at the Arab Spring, you know, I think that this is a very, very serious question. Thank you.
I guess that it's due to the depth and the complexity of the points raised here, we won't find the ultimate answer. So let's consider this as the start of a conversation. And for the sake of that, maybe just a couple of questions, two or three only. Please, less than a minute to add a little bit, and then keep on talking in a city that is very much adapted with a lot of public walkable space to keep on the conversation. So, question over here.
Hi, I'm an architect from Egypt, and I couldn't help walking in and listening to all of you. You know, it's inspiring to see mentors or people I've looked up to in my work. However, the question that I couldn't help but ask myself is, as a woman, and a brown woman, from the Arab Spring, from the developing countries, when we're talking about agency, and access, and voice of people, and projects that are catalyzing, or where, and when we're talking about spontaneous developments in cities like Cairo, where I came from, and seeing things like nobody's in charge when, in my opinion, everybody's actually in charge in Cairo. People are making the roads themselves and building their houses themselves. In some ways, it's just a different model. And maybe if you had allowed other voices to participate or created forums and platforms that allowed younger women from different you know, backgrounds to speak of their contexts themselves. I'm not saying it has to be someone from the public to make it truly participatory. I know this is a curated event, but you can find within the architectural public these voices. They exist, and they need to be heard for in order for the change that you're looking for. We're all looking for the same thing. We're all optimists. That's the nature of architects. But in order for that positive change to happen, there needs to be more inclusion. And that's, I mean, a comment and a question as to why or why not.
I don't know if somebody wants to take that question. I hope that this is not the only event, not the only representation of voices that are at the Biennale. So I hope that the collection of projects in there are meant to express the diversity, not only of the responses, of the questions, but also of the stakeholders. Actually, that's why we didn't call it the architects that invited to the Biennale, but participants with as many different backgrounds as possible, due to the very diverse nature of the questions that are here.
Okay. Thank you. My name is Panagiotis Koumoundouros. I'm an architect from Greece, and I have the honor of being one of the 136 participants of this year's Greek representation. Yesterday I gave a speech with the title Promethean, Not Practical, and I think that's what's needed today in this world, is a Promethean spirit in some, and I won't, you know, out of respect, mention who has attacked the Promethean spirit last year by name. But starting from the title, infrastructure, in order to do something about infrastructure, you cannot discuss infrastructure or superstructure without dealing with structure. And the structure today is more or less a known capitalist structure. What I posed and answered, because I don't want to take too much time, at the end of my speech is answering to what Corbu posed as a question in 1922, saying, architecture or revolution? And my experience in the past 50 years, starting from New York City in the late 60s and early 70s, where I studied there at City College and also at the Institute of Architecture and Urban Studies, and then coming back to Greece in 84, is that you need both architecture and revolution. Thank you.
So, to finalize, does anybody have a question? Thank you for coming. Was one?
Yeah. Hi, I'm Yanitsa. I would like to ask you, do we make our city too comfortable? Can we learn from a village? Because that was a little bit a topic you were talking about, and I would be just wonder, I don't know if you have been born in villages or in cities, but I always was shocked by the people in the cities that they are a little bit lazy to create our spaces around, to look at it. I'm not saying that it's happening everywhere, but I would just ask you, do you think we could learn from villages something which we would bring into the city and make us work on our space? Thank you.
Well, I don't know, but this idea of the village was, as I said, the main inspiration of Habitat One. The idea that we really, you know, we can live in the planet Earth as the human species in a smaller communities, etc. But I don't know why, and there's no good answer for that. This is not succeeding. This is not happening. I don't know if it's going to happen in the future. Of course, every urban model is a consequence of the socioeconomic model of the time. And we have grown up in the industrial city. And we are now moving to a post-industrial economy. And we don't know yet, because we don't know the future, at least I don't know the future, how the post-industrial society will organize its own architecture or urbanism. There's no answer to that yet. But it's difficult. We are going to reach 10 billion people. 10 billion people in planet Earth. And as Rem has said, by now the urban land is about 3% of the total population, and in this 3% of the land of the planet lives now 55% of the total world population. Then there's a lot of a struggle here in general, what is going to happen, because the arable land, it's something like 15 or 16%. And there's a lot of people who say, if we grow very much the urban footprint, then what is going to be questioned more or less is the arable land. And then there's a question mark here of how it's going to be the model of growth. Well, I've been grown up in a farm, not even in a village, and then I moved to the city later on. And yes, I can remember in the farm, we were not lazy, we were working very much. But I wouldn't say that the people in the cities are lazy. I would say that urbanization for a country like mine, which is Spain, and after the Civil War, where the wealth of the country was awful, $3,000 per capita, very low education, a lot of analphabetism, some parts of the country side with problems of massive health problems, like even one of the provinces of Spain was with problems of idiotism because of lack of oiate in the water. Then it was a very poor country, and of course, one of the ways that Spain was able to overcome the dictatorship and became a democratic country, it was in a big manner for the fight of the political fight of the let's say the left, the unions, the industry workers unionized, etc., and creating progressive parties in order to justify a social change that has at the end produced development. And that process has been an urbanization process. I don't know of any country which goes from $2,000 per capita to $30,000 per capita that does it without urbanization yet. And that it's something that we need to think at a long, can we reach some level of justice, good quality democracy? I am living now in Africa, many political arrangements in Africa are still tribally oriented. The elections, they are decided in many countries still by tribalism. Then careful to advocate for small villages. Who has the power in a small village? Who controls the society? Who establishes the values? Then it's not just the physical form, as it has been said. It's also the cultural and political transformation of the society. And this is the new paradigm that I think that contemporary architecture needs to recover. The linkage with politics. Sorry for being too long.
Thank you. Thank you. You have to leave. Maybe a closing remark by each of you. If you have to leave, you can start. But then each of you, if you want to say something to close.
I'm happy to say a few words on the basis that there's a small island near here, and there's an event related to the Biennale, a panel which I'm joining. So I have to be there at 5, and it's a little rude to walk out in the middle of an event. So maybe I just make a point about the village, which arose out of a study that was headed out by two colleagues, and they went to the informal settlement of Dharavi, which is a quarter of Mumbai, about the size of Hyde Park, with an estimated population between 1 and 3 million. It was the setting for the film Slumdog Millionaire, and we went at the invitation of a political party to look at how you might transform, upgrade that quarter from within rather than by bulldozing it. And it's interesting that one of the conclusions was exactly about public space. There was no public space. So one of the proposals was to build on the arteries. The other thing was to ask questions about why the only modern sanitation in that community was in a series of 14-story blocks that had been built on the edge to attract the informal settlers. They were empty, and we were finding the answers to why they were empty. And it was very much about the drive of the economy, which was recycling the waste of Mumbai, and it needed horizontality. And you couldn't really do it in more than 4 stories in terms of a walk-up. And part of our, besides building on the circulation arteries, creating more public space, and by insertions, and a later inspiration was the work that you were describing, and also how you could bring power on a self-sustaining basis. And the idea was that one component would take the elements that you would use for cooking, heating, cooling, harvesting power for light, and take the example from the automotive industry. And much later, and much more recently, a few months ago, I had the opportunity, I showed some of these ideas at a talk at Oxford University, and I instanced the very economical Tata car in India and said, if you could harness that technology, then you could use it as a weapon to transform, rather like the ideas behind the drone port. And I showed this to Ratan Tata and said, you know, just tell me if you think this is a nonsense. And his reaction was, no, I think it's terrific, I think it's great. But then, and this is a long-winded answer, he said, but really the needs are not just the cities in India, it's the rural communities. And if you could use that technology to transform life in the rural territories, then you would start to address and counter the move, the exodus into the cities, and it would be a much more balanced relationship between the agriculture, the city, and that would be truly transformative. I mean, he was full of advice and so on, which we are following up. Dharavi, he said, is too big a settlement to address. If you're going to do a pilot project, then pick a smaller community. It was a wider conversation, but I thought it was just very relevant to the question. So if you allow me, I'll move on to my next event. Thank you so much.
I think we're looking so much for the one answer for so many things. If we did this, if we did that, then everything would be some kind of better. I think it's interesting to wonder if there is a better and why we would want the better. Are things like they are now in their raw form not just what they are? And do we not just need to listen to people's their own imaginations of what they would dream their life to be, and see if we can make that a little bit more possible for them. As opposed to thinking that our job is to understand a range of information, almost like a doctor or a medical researcher, and if we can collect together the right amount of information and statistics and mapping, and we put all that together, we'll be able to come to some kind of conclusion that will satisfy the Western mentality of a single utopia, which comes from the idea of heaven. And maybe none of that really exists. And that it's more macro and more responsive and more involved and more in this room today and then in the next room tomorrow. And that we humble ourselves in some way as architects and become participants in a bigger ecology of things that are happening and see what small amount we can do to satisfy or solve problems, or even to see things as problems, but to listen to people's own dreams and enable that human potential. And maybe because I come from a family that made things, my father was a master carpenter or joiner. My understanding of that role, which I think is like an architect's role, is that the tools that you hold in your hands as a carpenter, a plane or a spoke shave or whatever it is, it makes a product possible, which is a chair or a table or whatever it might be, but you are quite removed from that. You just make that possible. I wonder if the product of architects is buildings and infrastructure and all that, or actually whether the product of our work is to make the possibilities of other people more realizable.
Well, instead of drawing conclusion, which is of course sometimes even not possible, let me add a few words about the problem that has been pointed out, relationship between architecture, politics, and so on and so forth. Well, we have to always to remember that public goods, and in particular public space, is not the result of voluntary restraints, but is the result of a central authority to which we give the power to act against us, against our individual interests. And that democracy is not voluntarism, but democracy is, and democratic system works if there are institutions through which we give the power to a central authority that will be able to tax us and to put constraint on the use of land that each of us would like to do or can do by itself. Then there is a second, there is a very famous theorem. Economists and politicians possibly, but economists in particular know it. The theorem deals with public goods, I mean goods or aims that are shared by a community. If the community is made of a little number of people, very little, and the smaller is the number of people that share this will, this desire, or this aspiration, the more likely is that the object can be obtained, because in the small community, each of the component has the precise idea and can measure that our action is marginally very important for the success, and our sacrifice is very important to reach the amount of resources that are necessary to get there. Unfortunately, this is one of the most dramatic theorems that economists and political economists has. The larger the community, the bigger the community that share or should share a common a public good, the least likely is that the common good is reached. Because each of the component of the big community doesn't appreciate his marginal contribution, and it, on the contrary, he might be led to what economists call the free rider approach or attitude. Well, why should I bother, given the fact that my contribution is irrelevant? I hope and I live just on expectations that others will do it. This is a tremendous, very tragic theorem that put as an axe gives a very big blow to the problem of joining representation vis-a-vis government. And if anything, I wish that New Habitat consider a bit more deeply the problem of which kind of institutions can manage such big, immense entity. Because we are still talking about government, we are talking about democracies, we are talking about the mayor of the cities, but we are talking about instruments that were invented for cities of 40,000, 50,000, 100,000 people. Are these tools sufficient, or just can they deal, being as they are, with problems of the millions and of the millions? Where this tragic theorem that makes that the bigger the community, the least likely is that the common interest is reached, is at work. Architecture cannot do it alone. The world of economists and the world of political economists and experts of institutions and constitutions has to join in to find out new ways of work, new ways of framing the institution, because it's certainly not enough to say democracy, to say more participation, to say all these wonderful values that assume the ideal, but unfortunately not true, assumption that the more we are, the more likely is the goal, the common goal can be reached, or the fact that having public goods is the result of self-restraint. Unfortunately, this is not. And so the mayor of a small city is not the same thing as the mayor of the 20 million inhabitants. The structure of the institutions have to be redesigned in such a way as to reduce the gap between the possibility of representations and the possibility of having governments, which means the possibility of accepting together to give up some sovereignty of ours to a common institution that will act against each of us, because we have accepted that this has to happen for the common good, for the common good that we want. It's not an easy task, but architecture alone cannot certainly not do it.
That being said, thank you for coming.